Okay, good morning. Let us start. I will start with answering few questions which we have received through our forum. There is one question which probably is not very well framed, but you know, let me just, I think I understood the question. It says, what will prevent tunneling, increase in height or increase in width of the potential? Probably what it means that, you know, how the tunneling probability will decrease, whether by increasing height or by increasing the width. In fact, it is done by both. I had given you the expression of actually inverse of transmission coefficient. You can see both width as well as the height of the potential barrier comes there. So it depends actually on both. The next question is that can a particle with zero rest mass travel more than the speed of light? No, because as we just now, I mean last time saw that a particle, I mean of course we have not introduced photon, which I will do today, will travel exactly with the speed of light. There is no other way. I mean I will show that this is in order to maintain the consistency in the equations of special theory of relativity, it is necessary. There is another question is, does a Michelson-Morley experiment uphold mass energy equivalence? See, mass energy equivalence is something different as today I'll be discussing. Okay, so as far as Michelson-Morley experiment was concerned, it was only to test whether the speed of light is a frame dependent quantity. So at least I cannot see any direct relevance with the mass energy equivalence. See, mass energy equivalence comes when we actually take the postulates of special theory of relativity, and in order to maintain those postulates we require some change in some of the basic equations, and then mass energy relationship comes in. Then Earth is a inertial or non-inertial frame of reference, that I think we have discussed number of times, that is actually non-inertial frame of reference. I mean there is nothing like real inertial frame of reference, but for many practical purposes we can treat this as inertial frame of reference. Then you know there is about length contraction, whether it has a physical significance or not. Of course I have not talked about length contraction, but somebody asked about time dilation. So I sort of introduced time dilation. At that time I mentioned briefly about the length contraction. Of course length contraction is always real if you are going from one frame to another frame of reference. So that is absolutely no issue. See, what you are seeing as the proper length of a particular rod in a frame of reference, and that length has to be along the direction of the relative velocity, then you will always find that whenever a measurement is done to measure the length of that particular rod in a different frame of reference, you will find it contracted. Of course, this contraction will be visible only when you know the relative velocity between the frames is very close to the velocity of light. When I had said that even if it is 0.1 c, which is fairly large velocity, there also you will not be able to, I mean you are making only 1% correction in the classical equations. Then I think there are two more questions. Why the Galilean transformation failed on the basis of electromagnetic theory? That is what I had explained, that because according to Galilean transformation, we will have the classical relative velocity formula, and application of that relative formula will tell you that the speed should be different in different frames, okay, which as I said has a problem, because first of all speed of light is given in terms of the basic fundamental constants, but more importantly then you know there is a Michelson-Morley experiment which shows that the light does not seem to be frame dependent. Then there was a, is it possible to show a video clip? Unfortunately, I do not have any video clip of Michelson-Morley experiment arrangement. I mean, I would suggest the best thing would be that, you know, you look at, do a Google search. There is a possibility that you may see some of the clips. Okay, I think these were some of the questions. So, now let us come back to my last lecture in this particular thing. It was a pleasure discussing and talking to you. So, this is what we discussed last time. We discussed that time is frame dependent. That is what Einstein thought, that is probably the only way to maintain that speed of light is frame independent is to make time frame dependent. Okay, so it was one thing which we discussed last time in detail. Then we discussed the actual Lorentz transformation, which replaces the classical Galilean transformation. Then from that we obtained the velocity transformation, which ensures that the speed of light is same in all the frames. And then we say that this is the most general velocity transformation. Of course, again like Lorentz transformation, you can see that only when the relative velocities are of the order of speed of light, then you will start seeing its effect or its difference from the classical formula. Otherwise, the classical formula of relative velocity, if the velocities are not that large, would still hold good. Then I worked out one or two examples, rather one example, to see how we calculate relative velocity. But, and then in answer of one of the questions, I mentioned that, you know, if I take one particular particle, which let us say in Earth's frame of reference is traveling at speed 0.6c or 0.8c, and there is another particle which is coming with particle level with a speed velocity of light, okay, then in that frame of reference also when we transform, that particular person will find the speed of the particle to be speed of light. So this is what was actually required when we are talking about the velocity transformation, because that was the postulate. Now we go to one step forward. We have only tried to ensure the second postulate of special theory of relativity, which says that speed of light is same in all the inertial frames of reference. Okay, we have not tested the first hypothesis or first postulate, which says that laws of physics are same in all the inertial frames. Now question is that, is this enough? Is just changing Galilean transformation to Lorentz transformation is enough, and is that the only modification that we need? Okay, the answer to that question is that no, that is not enough. Okay, we require some more changes so that my laws of physics became consistent with the, or rather my expressions, not, I will not say laws of physics, but my expressions turned out to be consistent with the first postulate, which says that laws of physics should always be frame independent. So to explain this thing, I will take one very simple example. This is often taken in most of the textbooks, it's taken. This is about the law of conservation of momentum, which we believe that is a fundamental law of physics. So if we have only the Lorentz transformation and the velocity transformation as derived from the Lorentz transformation, then if we take a normally standard classical inelastic collision, okay, we will find that in this particular case, if the momentum is conserved in one frame, it may not be conserved in any other frame of reference. Okay, it means the law of conservation of momentum will turn out to be frame dependent, which I cannot allow because of my first postulate, which says that laws of physics should remain same in all the inertial frame of reference. Then it essentially means that we have to change the definition of momentum, and eventually we will find out that we will have to change the definition of energy. Then only you will maintain the universality of law of conservation of momentum and law of conservation of energy. It means in all the inertial frames, momentum and energy will turn out to be conserved. If they are conserved in one frame, in another frame, they will also turn out to be conserved. So let us take this very simple example and let us try to see that just velocity transformation derived on the basis of Lorentz transformation is not good enough. So this is what I have written in this particular slide, need to redefine momentum. So essentially this is to say that we have to relook at the definition of momentum. So I said this is a completely inelastic collision, which we probably know right from classical mechanics, even in high school people know this particular problem very, very well. Okay, this is in which, let us suppose this is a frame S in which we are observing this particular collision. Okay, of course, I have taken the speeds which are very large so that, you know, we can see the relativistic effects. So let us suppose there is one particular mass which is traveled to the right, which is traveling to the right hand side with a speed of 0.6 c, and there is another mass which is traveling to the left hand side with a speed of 0.6 c, and the two masses are same. Then they collide and they get stuck to each other and they come to rest. Okay, as I said, this is called a completely inelastic collision in the traditional classical mechanics. In this case, we always tell the students that momentum will of course will be conserved, but the energy will not be conserved, because this particular particle will have energy, classically speaking, half mv square, and this is half mv square. So overall the total energy will be equal to mv square, but after they collide they come to rest. Okay, and when they come to rest, the kinetic energy turns out to be zero. So this energy is not conserved. On the other hand, momentum turns out to be conserved, because momentum turns out to be m times v, and this is also m into v, and remember momentum is a vector quantity. So this momentum is in the negative x direction, this is in the plus x direction. So overall momentum of the system will be zero, and when they have come to rest, then of course the velocity is zero, so momentum is zero. So momentum is conserved and energy is not conserved. Of course, in that case also we tell students, see, remember when we are talking that energy is not conserved, we are talking only of the mechanical energy, it is only the kinetic energy which is not conserved. Actually the energy is converted into a different form, which is not really the mechanical in nature. For example, when they collide, okay, then some sound may come out, or the material may get heated up, somewhere this particular energy has to be utilized. Okay, but these are not really in the form of mechanical energy. Overall energy we do expect to be conserved, but in the traditional classical mechanics the mechanical energy is not conserved in this process. Now let us apply my relative velocity formula. Of course, as I have just now said, that energy and is not conserved, classical energy is not conserved, momentum is conserved. Okay. Now, let me observe this particular collision from a different frame, and let us assume that this particular frame is the one which is also moving to the right hand side with a speed of 0.6c. So, let us suppose this frame in which I have described this collision is a frame S, and let us now go to a frame S prime, okay, which is moving in this particular direction plus x direction with a speed of 0.6c. Okay. We will use the relative velocity formula which we have just now derived, or rather derived last time, okay, and see that in this particular frame of reference momentum will not turn out to be conserved. So, as far as this particular S frame is concerned, this momentum turns out to be conserved. Let us look into this thing. So, in S frame, as we have agreed, that initial momentum is 0 when I say sum of initial momentum of the two particles, as I just now said, because one moves with the same velocity on the left hand side, another moves with the right hand side, and being momentum being vector, if I take the sum of the momenta of the two particles, that will turn out to be 0, and final momentum is also 0. So, momentum is conserved. Okay, at the moment I am looking only at the conservation of momentum aspect. Now, let us view this collision from another frame S prime with a velocity v is equal to 0.6c using a velocity transformation. Yesterday I worked out a problem how to find out relative velocity, how to change the velocity to a different frame of reference. Do the same thing now for this particular problem. So, I will try to find out what will be the velocity of this particular particle in this S prime frame. I will also try to find out what will be the velocity of this particular particle in this S prime frame. Then what is the velocity of this particular particle which is now at rest in S frame, in S prime frame, and then try to apply conservation of momentum to see whether momentum is conserved or not. Okay, so let us go to S prime frame of reference. Now, we start looking at the velocity of the first particle. Let us look here. Because I am going to a frame of reference where we have v is equal to 0.6c, this is what I have said. So, it is 0.6c is the velocity, and this particular particle which was moving on the right hand side also has a velocity of 0.6c. So, it means ux is also equal to 0.6c. So, if I want to find out the velocity in this particular frame of reference which is traveling with the speed of 0.6c in frame S, then ux prime will be equal to ux minus v divided by 1 minus ux into v upon c square. Okay. Ux is equal to 0.6c, v is equal to 0.6c, numerator will become 0. So, ux prime would be equal to 0, which is understandable because in that particular frame is traveling exactly with the same speed of as the particle. So, it is nothing surprising to see that the velocity of this particular particle turns out to be 0. So, this is what I have written. This is prime of the first particle. I have written x because of course there is only x component here. So, I need not have written, but you know nevertheless I have written it. So, this is 0.6c minus 0.6c I have substituted here, but that is not necessary. It becomes 0. This is as expected. Now, exactly same thing I will do for another particle, second particle. Thing is that there instead of 0.6c it will be minus 0.6c. So, numerator will become minus 1.2c. So, this is what is written in the next transparency, minus 0.6c, minus 0.6c, and here of course, it will become 1 plus because ux is negative. So, you have 1 minus ux into v, and ux being negative that becomes 1 plus ux into v upon c square. So, denominator will become 1.36. I mean, I had exactly worked out this type of problem yesterday. So, second particle's speed in this S prime frame of reference will turn out to be minus 1.2 divided by 1.36c. Now, let us look at that particular particle which is at rest. For that particular particle, you have this 0 here, and because you have 1 minus ux into v upon c square, ux being 0, so denominator this particular term will not be present. So, after the velocity of the combined particle after the collision, ux turns out to be 0 because in S frame that particular particle is at rest, okay, minus v divided by 1 minus this. So, this is also equal to minus 1.6c. This is also consistent with the standard classical result, because remember this particular denominator term, this particular term turns out to be 0, and numerator was the classical term. Okay. So, now according to S prime observer, first particle is at rest, okay. Second particle travels with this speed, third particle which is a resultant particle after the collision will travel with the speed of minus 0.6c. So, I apply conservation of momentum. It means first particle has of course zero momentum in S prime because its speed is zero. Second particle will have moment of minus 1.2 divided by 1.36 times c multiplied by mass. Here it will be 0.16 and of course the mass of this particular particle will be 2m. So, minus 1.6 into 2mc. As you can see here this will be 1.2 while here it will be 1.2 divided by 1.36. It means the momentum, initial momentum will be different from the final momentum. So, according to S prime frame of reference, when this collision occurred, momentum was not conserved if he applied only the velocity transformation equation. But this is an outcome which I cannot accept because this violates the first postulate of relativity, which says that all laws of physics should be same in all inertial frame of reference. It means just applying relative velocity formula to this particular problem was not correct. We need something more. Basically, we need to redefine momentum. The initial and the final momentum in S prime is given by this particular thing. So, initial momentum is minus 1.6 and of course, so final momentum is minus 1.2 mc. The initial momentum will be minus 1.2 because momentum of the first particular particle is 0. So, this will be the initial momentum, this is the final momentum which is not conserved according to S prime. Now, unfortunately, I do not have time to give you a little bit more logic on how momentum is redefined. I will just give you the expression of momentum and will emphasize more on how to use this particular expression of momentum and eventually energy, okay, to solve certain problems. Okay. In fact, one can give some certain amount of logic to come to this particular why momentum has to be defined and how the universality of conservation of momentum and conservation of energy is maintained with this new definition. Okay. This is something which I will not be able to touch here. And again, I say that, you know, if you are more interested, you know, can, I have also a series of video on YouTube, you can probably watch or you can look at any other textbook. This is something which is covered in most of the textbooks. So, now we go to a new definition of momentum. First of all, we define a quantity which we call as a rest mass. It is a mass which is measured in a frame of reference in which the particle is at rest. So, we define a quantity which is called m naught. Then we define momentum as m naught times gamma u. Okay, let me just spend 1 minute to explain these gammas because there are so many gammas which are coming. See, so long there is only one gamma. See, earlier if you remember, we defined gamma as 1 upon under root 1 minus v square by c square, where v was the relative velocity between the two frames, okay, from between which we are seeking a transformation. All right. Now, I define two more gammas, one what I call as gamma u and another what I call as gamma u prime. See, remember when we are talking about the velocity transformation, at that time we talked of three different speeds or three different velocities. First velocity was the relative velocity between the frames for which we reserved the symbol v. Then we said that a particle is being observed by the observers in the two different frames. When an observer in S frame observes this particular particle, he or she notices its instantaneous velocity to be u. So, u is reserved for the particle velocity and as I have been emphasizing earlier, u need not be constant, v has to be constant. Okay. Now, the velocity of the same particle is being observed by another observer in an S prime frame of reference and what that observer finds the velocity of the particle will be represented by u prime. Again, u prime need not be constant. Okay. Now, if I use an expression exactly identical to this, but instead of v, I use either u or u prime, I will call it gamma u or gamma u prime. When unfortunately, we have to define these symbols to make equations look simpler. Otherwise, you know, the equations itself writing takes enormous amount of space. So, here we are using u. Remember, u and u prime need not be constant. Therefore, gamma u and gamma u prime need not be constant. As a function of time, they could change. Well, as far as gamma is concerned, because gamma is dependent on v and v has to be constant, gamma will be constant. So, this is just to emphasize on the symbols that I am using. So suppose I know the speed of a particular particle in a given frame of reference, this speed is defined as u, then using this expression I can calculate what is gamma u. Of course, if the speed of the particle changes, gamma u will also change. But let's suppose we are talking at a given instant when the speed of the particle is u, okay, then I calculate gamma u, then I multiply this particular quantity called rest mass by gamma u multiplied by ux. Remember, in the traditional definition of momentum, we just have m times ux. All that is getting multiplied is this particular factor gamma u. Now, similarly, as far as the y component of the momentum is concerned, exactly the same thing. We define this as m naught gamma u uy. Pz, I define this as m naught gamma u uz, and because these are definitions, so I have put 3 bars here to say that these are the way we define momentum in relativity. Alright. So, see, we define rest mass m naught, which is the mass of the particle measured in a frame when the mass is at rest, then we define Px, Py, Pz using this particular thing. Now, similarly, if I have to find out the momentum in S prime frame of reference, u will turn out to be different, then I will use u prime, this u will become u prime, this will also become u prime, this will also become u prime. Of course, I will not be able to do again momentum transformation, but as I said, I will just discuss about the new definition of momentum and energy and try to use it to solve certain problems. So, note in S prime frame of reference, u will turn out to be different, because the same particle velocity will be measured, will be found out different. Okay, of course, that will be, that can be found out by using velocity transformation. So, then this u prime will, using this u prime, I can calculate what is gamma u prime. I use this particular gamma u prime multiplied by the x component of the velocity as observed in S prime frame of reference, then m naught gamma u prime u x prime will give me the x component of the momentum. Similarly, y component, similarly the z component. Now, the next question is that, is this enough? If we define this wave of momentum, as I said, I will not be able to discuss why we are going to this particular definition and how this particular definition ensures that momentum is conserved in all the frame of reference. But it just, let us say that we have introduced it, let us say rather abruptly. Now, question is that if we define this particular thing, does that ensure that momentum will be conserved in all the frames? Okay, unfortunately, you can show that this does not happen. Okay, just conservation of momentum will not work out, we require further change. So, as sort of I ask, only momentum conservation, does the new definition of momentum guarantees universality of conservation of momentum? The answer is no. Okay, in fact, what can be shown that along with momentum, you must conserve energy also, then only a universality of conservation of momentum will be maintained. So, momentum and energy have to be conserved together in any process, whether what I am calling this particular process as a completely inelastic, in a process that was a process, okay, in which traditionally we thought energy is not conserved, or rather mechanical energy was not conserved. Okay. So, then Einstein proposed his well-known formula of new definition of an energy, which is essential to be conserved if momentum has to be conserved in all the inertial frames of reference. So, this is what I am saying, energy in relativity, a totally new expression of energy is proposed in relativity, which is E is equal to m naught times gamma u into c square. This gamma u into m naught is often written as m, okay, and we often call it that mass is velocity dependent. Of course, very large number of my colleagues who actually work in the area of particle physics, which I do not do, they always try to call, when they say mass, they always call it rest mass, and they say that is just m naught gamma u c square, but you know that is, I would not like to come into that particular thing. Okay. This is a very standard way of writing this particular thing, that you write E is equal to m naught gamma u c square, which is often written as m c square, where m is m naught multiplied by gamma u. Okay. Now, what is this energy? If I am having u is equal to 0, it means particle is at rest. Okay. Remember, my gamma u was having this expression, if this u is 0, gamma u is 1. Okay. Also, if u is very small in comparison to c, gamma u is approximately equal to 1. Okay. So, u is equal to 0, gamma u is equal to 1. It means momentum will be, which is defined as this particular thing, will become 0 because u anyway is 0. Okay. So this is consistent with the classical expression, because in classically, if a particle is at rest, the momentum should be zero, and with the new definition of momentum, also momentum turns out to be zero. But in this particular expression of energy, if I put gamma u is equal to 1, actually I get E is equal to m naught c square. Okay. Unfortunately, this does not match with the classical expression, because classically we thought that if the particle is at rest, and let us suppose if there is no potential energy, the total energy is zero. Okay. On the other hand, with this new definition of energy, even if the particle is at rest, it will have energy which is called m naught c square. I mean, this is very, very epoch making, as I have discussed, very, very important and with far reaching consequences, this particular very, very brilliant way of by Einstein to define energy. Similarly, if u is very, very small in comparison to c, gamma u is also equal to 1 and p will turn out to be equal to m naught u, which matches with the classical definition of momentum. So, as far as the definition of momentum is concerned, okay, all that you have done is multiplied by a factor of gamma u, which is somewhat velocity dependent. Of course, it will become significant only when u is very, very close to c. Okay. So, but this definitely yields to a classical definition of momentum in the classical limit. But on the other hand, for energy, this does not turn out to be so. In fact, in the classical limit, the energy will not be 0, but energy will be equal to m naught c square. This is a totally a new form of energy which does not have any classical analog. Okay. The new form of energy does not resemble any classically known form of energy. It is a totally, entirely a new concept of energy. I mean, that is why so much importance is attached to Einstein that about this particular thing. Now, what Einstein proposed, that any type of energy when you are talking, okay, whenever there is a energy gain or energy loss, irrespective of what type of energy that we are talking, okay, it will result into an increase or decrease of the mass. So, for example, if there is a particular particle which is at rest and I heat it, okay, I know that this particular energy has been supplied to this particular particle. When the energy has been supplied to this particular particle, even though this particular particle is at rest, in principle its rest mass would have gone up, okay, because it is having more energy. Okay. Similarly, if a particular particle cools down, it has emitted energy. If it has emitted energy, its rest mass should go down. Okay. And if this particular particle starts traveling, okay, then it will gain some kinetic energy, and that kinetic energy will be different, as I will give you the expression, from the new value of mc square and what was the original value of m naught c square, which is the rest mass energy. M naught c square we often call rest mass energy. Similarly, if you are taking two particles, let us say an electron and proton, and they are at infinite distance, you bring them and you form a hydrogen atom, and let us suppose this hydrogen atom is in the ground state, then you will find the 13.6 electron volt energy will be released, because this particular system of bound hydrogen atom in which electron and proton are bound has a lower energy than a system in which electron and protons are infinite distance away. So, if you take a mass of electron and you take a mass of proton, okay, infinite distance away, you make them hydrogen atom, okay, take the mass of the hydrogen atom, the mass of the hydrogen atom will be smaller than the sum of the mass of electron and proton, okay, divided by c square. Okay, it is a very, very far reaching thing. In fact, as probably all of you know, that many of the mass defect problems on nuclear physics, where by measuring the mass of the nuclei, we estimate what is the binding energy of nucleus. Now, people attempt now with these things. Okay. It is a totally a new concept of energy. Okay. And we say, because now mass can be expressed in the units of energy, as these two are related through a fundamental constants. So, generally, I mean, if you ask again a particle physicist, there is no difference between mass and energy, because they are related by a fundamental constant. Okay. In fact, to a particle physicist, if you ask what is the mass of the electron, he will say half MeV or 0.51 MeV. Okay. MeV, which is mega electron volt, is the unit of energy, but they are so used to expressing mass in terms of only energies. Okay. What is the mass of the proton? 938 MeV, or normally they take approximately as 1 GeV. Okay. These are all units of energy, but the things that mass can always be converted into unit of energy, because there is a fundamental constant c square which is involved. Now, as I said, we can define kinetic energy. Let us suppose there is a particular particle which has a particular rest mass energy, and if this particular particle starts moving, the difference between the two energy will be termed as the kinetic energy. So, k is equal to mc square minus m naught c square, because remember this energy is always present when even when the particle is at rest. So whatever the additional amount of energy that this particular particle has obtained as a result of its motion, okay, that difference will be, or that particular additional energy will be called kinetic energy. So this is what is the expression of kinetic energy. Because remember, gamma u I can write as 1 upon under root 1 minus u square by c square, and should be minus m naught c square. So this particular thing I can write as 1 minus u square by c square to the power minus half. Then again you expand in the binomial expansion. If you expand, you will get this multiplied by plus half, assuming that u is very smaller than c. I neglect higher order terms. So this I can write as m naught c square into 1 plus u square by 2 c square. Remember, the sign is plus because there is a negative sign here. This sign is 2 here, there this number is 2 here because there is a 2 here. Minus m naught c square. This m naught c square will cancel it out and you will get half m naught u square. So in the classical limit, when u is very small in comparison to c, this expression does resemble the standard classical expression for kinetic energy. So in fact, it is this expression of k which matches the classical expression of energy and not the expression for E. Okay, E is very, very different concept which does not exist in classical physics. So these are our new definitions. P is equal to mu, where I have defined m is equal to this particular quantity. E is equal to mc square, where again I have defined m is this thing, and k is equal to mc square minus m naught c square. Now before I try attempt working out certain problems, okay, let us use one of the very, very important thing, the energy and momentum relationship, which is very, very important, because remember, whenever we try to work out the collision problem, we write momentum conservation, we write energy conservation, and then we relate energy to the momentum. In a classical standard collision experiment, the relationship is very simple. E just turns out to be equal to p square by 2m. So these two equations, one on momentum conservation, another on energy conservation, can be linked through this particular equation. But now what we will be seeing, we have to obtain a similar expression which is valid in relativity, and that is what I am going to do just now. So this is what I am calling as energy momentum relationship. So I try to evaluate what is p square minus e square by c square. P square I have just now defined as this particular quantity. E square I had defined as m naught gamma u square c, actually e square should be c to the power 4, but there is a divided by c square, so this remains c square, alright. The dimension of e by c is the same as the dimension of momentum, okay. You just take here m naught gamma u square common, so this becomes minus u square minus c square, okay. Now you write this gamma square as 1 upon under root 1 minus u square by c square, do a little bit of manipulation. Mathematical manipulation, you will get that this expression will turn out to be minus m naught square c square. So this is a very, very standard relationship which we always remember and use in relativity. E square is equal to p square c square plus m naught square c to the power 4. Remember, this relationship exists is between momentum of a particle and the total relativistic energy. Many times to differentiate what type of energy we mean, this E often we call as the total relativistic energy, okay, just to differentiate it from total classical energy, which is generally written as potential energy plus kinetic energy, alright. So this is the relationship which we will be using in some of the problems later. Sometimes we are also interested in finding out a relationship between kinetic energy and momentum, alright. So that expression also I am giving, but most of the time we tend to use this particular expression, but you know, in case it is needed, we can also use this particular expression, the relationship between kinetic energy and momentum. Okay, we have just now derived this equation, so I am just taking this p square c square as e square minus m naught square c to the power 4. So this is what I have written here, e square c square is equal to e square minus m naught square c to the power 4. Now e I write as k plus m naught c square, because this is the way I had defined the kinetic energy earlier. K is equal to this thing, so your e will turn out to be k plus m naught c square. So k plus m naught c square to the power square, so take expand this square, so you will get k square plus 2 m naught c square k, and then you will get m naught square c to the power 4, which will cancel with this. So you will get p square c square is equal to k square plus 2 m naught c square k, okay. This is the relationship between the kinetic energy and momentum, and this in the classical limit, meaning u becoming very small in comparison to c, should give you standard definition of kinetic energy is equal to p square by 2 m. That is what I am trying to show. This was this expression, I take k out, this is k plus 2 m naught c square. Now in the limit that kinetic energy is very, very small in comparison to 2 m naught c square, now you can neglect this particular term k, and then you will get c square will cancel, you will get k is equal to p square by 2 m naught which is the classical expression, classical relationship between the momentum and energy. So, in fact, you know, whenever we are trying to solve energy momentum problem, okay, students often ask the question, when I am going to use relativistic expression, when I am bound to use relativistic expression, when I can use classical expressions. Of course, classical expressions are simple enough. So, if at all I can use classical expression, nothing like it. But if I cannot use, or if I am going to get wrong result by using classical expression, I should use relativistic expression. Now, in the simple kinematics, it is rather easy to say that whenever the velocities are close to velocity of light, in fact, I have told you that, you know, if v is of the order of 0.1 c, you make only 1% correction. Okay? So, you know what are the limits when your v is, let us say, lying between, or speeds that are we are interested are lying between 0.1 c and let us say c, that time you are probably have to use the classical the relativistic expression. In terms of energy, the limit that we always describe, that in order that this particular thing has to be maintained, k should be much smaller than the rest mass energy. So, if I am talking of the energy in terms of energy, okay, I can use classical expression so long my kinetic energy of the particle is much smaller in comparison to its rest mass energy. Just now I have told you that an electron has approximately a rest mass energy m naught c square is of the order of half MeV, 0.5 MeV. Okay? So, if there is a problem which says that one particular electron travels with an energy, with a kinetic energy of 1 keV, this 1 keV is very small in comparison to half MeV. Okay? So, I can use the classical expression. But if I say that there is a one particular electron which is moving with the speed, which has a total kinetic energy of, let us say, 1 MeV, then you are bound to use relativistic expression, because this k cannot be neglected in terms of in comparison to 2m0 c square. So, basically the thumb rule is that if your kinetic energies are much smaller than rest mass energy, you can go to the classical limit, otherwise you must use relativistic expressions. Now, let me repeat, in every process both energy and momentum have to be conserved. In the completely inelastic collision discussed earlier, the rest mass of the final particle will be larger than the sum of the rest masses of the initial particles. Now, I will come back to this particular problem and try to show this particular aspect. So, I use the same example. Now, I work out with the correct expression. Now, I have got my correct expression of momentum. I have got now my correct expression of energy. And I know that this particular problem cannot just be solved by applying only conservation of momentum. So, now let us try to solve this problem correctly using the new expressions, and then show that both energy and momentum will be conserved in S and S prime frame of reference. So, the problem is exactly identical as before. Only thing I am using now correct equations, okay, to signify that momentum will be conserved in both S and S prime frame of reference. So, again you had similar type of situation before collision, a mass going like this, mass going like this, each speed is 0.6 c, and after collision it turns out to be this much. Normally, you will find in many of relativity issues, we always prefer to use speeds 0.6 c or 0.8 c, because the gamma value turned out to be somewhat cleaner. So, let me just write this particular thing. Gamma u, which is 1 upon under root 1 minus u square by c square. If u is equal to 0.6 c, okay, u square will become 0.36 c. square. If I substitute it here, I get 1 minus, this is 0.36, c square will cancel out, so you will get 1 minus 0.36. Remember, gamma u is dimensionless quantity. So, this becomes 1 divided by under root 0.64. Fortunately, the under root of this particular thing is fairly clean, so this divided by 1.0.8. which is 1.25. Similarly, you can show that for u is equal to 0.8 c also, the gamma value turns out to be fairly clean. So, whenever we are trying to emphasize only the concepts, okay, often we use the speeds which are sort of gives you a clean number for gammas. Okay. So, that is why 0.6 c is a very standard thing. So, now I find the momentum of the first particle in S frame itself. Okay. So, I know that initial momentum will turn out to be 0, but nevertheless, let me write the correct expression for momentum. So, this is the momentum of the first particle before collision. The momentum of this, let us suppose this is the rest mass of the particle m naught multiplied by gamma u, because its speed is 0.6 c. Okay. So, just now I have said that gamma will turn out to be 1.25 for this. So, this is 1.25 and u is supposed to be the speed of this particular particle, which is 0.6c. So, this momentum will now be given by 1.25 multiplied by 0.6 m naught c. So, this gamma introducing is necessary with the, because of the new definition of momentum. Remember, when I worked out this problem earlier, I had not used this term, which was not correct because at that time I did not have a new definition of momentum, which will turn out to be 0.75 m naught c. Similarly, for the second particle, it is the same thing except there is a negative sign here. I used exactly the same expression. I will get the momentum to be minus 0.75 m naught c, and as you can see, that sum of the momentum will be 0. Plus 0.75 minus 0.75 will give you 0. So, this is expected, this is nothing surprising, okay, but now I have used the correct expression for momentum. Clearly, the final momentum is also 0 because, you know, of course, gamma u will be 1 and u anyway is 0. So, the momentum is going to be 0. So, therefore, you will find out that the momentum of the particle after the resultant particle will also be 0. But now energy must also be conserved. It is necessary that energy is conserved, otherwise I will not be able to maintain the universality of conservation of energy and conservation of momentum, which I am illustrating by using this particular problem. So, now I have to write what is the initial energy of the particle. Remember, in S frame, I have not yet gone to S prime frame. So, the energy will be given by mc square. So, this is m naught gamma u, which I have just now calculated as 1.25. Okay, so the energy of this particular first particular particle is 1.25 m naught c square. Similarly, the energy of the second particle is also 1.25 m naught c square. And you know, energy is not a vector quantity. So, when I take the total sum of the energy, both have to be added, like a classical thing, the kinetic energy have to be added there. Okay, kinetic energy cannot be subtracted from each other because they are not vector quantities. On the other hand, momentum have to be subtracted because they are in different direction and momentum is a vector quantity. All right. So, according to me, now the total energy will turn out to be 2.5 m naught c square. So, in S frame, the particle, the observer will now find that the rest mass of the particle is 2.5 m naught. See, first particle rest mass was m naught, second was m naught. Okay, but now the new particle that has come does not have a rest mass of 2 m naught, but has 2.5 m naught. Why it has increased? Because there is certain amount of energy which has been supplied. See, remember, in classical mechanics, the energy was not conserved, but that was not lost. Okay, but that energy now has resulted in an increase of its rest mass as far as relativity is concerned, because this energy is supposed to take care of all forms of energies. So, this is 2.5 m naught c square. So, rest mass of this particle would have gone up. Okay, now hence the final energy of the particle should be same, even though the speed of the combined particle is 0. So, it means that particular particle has only rest mass energy. The resultant particle, which has been formed as a result of the collision of these two particles, because it is at rest in S frame. So, whatever this particular particle has the energy must be only its rest mass energy. So, this m naught is equal to c square, hence the rest mass of the combined particle is 2.5 m naught, which is what I just now explained. Okay, the total energy will turn out to be 2.5 times m naught. So, mass being instead of 2 m naught has become 2.5 m naught, because overall there has been some energy which has been taken by this particular combined mass in addition to their normal standard. Okay, now let us try to go back to S prime frame of reference and try to see that now with these new ideas, the momentum and energy are both conserved. Okay, in fact, you will see that if this I have not used this particular term, I would not have got momentum conservation again. It is necessary to conserve this energy also in order to get momentum conserved in S prime frame of reference. Let us see this thing. Let us go to S prime frame. Velocity I have already calculated for the first particle, which turns out to be 0. Okay, and again, momentum of this particle will turn out to be 0 because u itself is 0. Okay, so even if you multiply by gamma u, it does not make a difference because you multiply it by 0, so you will get it 0. So, as far as the first particle is concerned, okay, in S prime frame, like before, momentum will turn out to be 0. But now let us look at the second particle for which we had earlier calculated the velocity. Okay, and now I have to calculate the momentum using new definition of momentum. So, this was the velocity that I have obtained. Now, I have to calculate the momentum using this particular definition. So, what I will have to do, I have to not only multiply by m naught, but I have to multiply by gamma u. And when I calculate gamma u, the value of u that I have to take will be this. Alright. So, this is what I am doing here. If I calculate the momentum, I multiplied by m naught c, this was my original velocity. okay, but I have to multiply it by 1 upon under root 1 minus u square by c square, and u is 1.2 upon 1.36 c square will cancel it out. So, the second momentum of the second particle in this particular frame of reference will turn out to be this. Earlier we had used only this particular term, so we did not get the momentum conservation. Now, I have to use this particular term, alright, and there is a negative sign because this particle in S prime frame of reference of course moves in minus x direction. So, you do a little bit of mathematics, you will find out that this momentum of the second particle will turn out to be minus 1.875 m naught c, okay, m naught c has the dimension of momentum, okay. So, this is the momentum of the second particle. If I take total initial momentum will be in first particle is 0, second particle is minus 1.875. So, the total momentum of the system was minus 1.875 m naught c. I hope it is clear. Now, let us look whether the momentum is conserved. So, I consider now the second particle, okay. When I consider the second particle, okay, not only I have already calculated the velocity, okay. Using that, I have to calculate gamma u, calculate new momentum, but the rest mass that I have to take now because of energy conservation will not be m naught, but will be 2.5 m naught. And remember that is necessary in order that I get momentum conservation. If I still would have used 2 m naught, I would not have got momentum conservation. How did I get 2.5 m naught? Because I also conserved energy in S frame. This I have shown it earlier, the velocity of the combined particle after the collision will be minus 0.6 c. Momentum of the combined particle with 0.6, I will get gamma u, which will turn out to be equal to 1.25. This is 1.25, 0.6, but now I have to use m naught c, okay. This is the rest mass energy of the combined particle, which I had obtained from conservation of energy. So, this I have used 2.5 times m naught, I will get minus 1.875 m naught c. Now, momentum will turn out to be conserved, but remember this turned out to be conserved even after the new definition of momentum. Only after I conserved energy and obtained that the new rest mass is 2.5 m naught. But this is what I am trying to emphasize, okay. Even in a process like classical process in which it was a completely inelastic process, both energy and momentum have now to be conserved, okay. This may result to a different rest mass, that is a different question. Now, let us satisfy ourselves that energy is also conserved, okay. Not only energy, but the momentum also should be conserved. Initial energy S prime frame of reference, what is the energy? First particle was at rest in S prime frame of reference, so it has only the rest mass energy, which is m naught c square. Second particle was having a speed of 1.2 divided by 1.36 c. So, using that particular thing, I will calculate gamma u, so it will be gamma u times m naught c square, alright. Now, the total initial energy in S prime, not kinetic, the total initial energy of the system in S prime frame of reference. Final energy will be now gamma u m naught c square, the particle is only is moving with a speed of minus 0.6 c. So, I calculate this, I have taken as 1.25, this indeed turns out to be 3.125 m naught c square. So, you can see that the energy is also conserved. Now, let us come to the concept of what we call as a zero rest mass particle, which I had used when I was talking about the photon. In fact, I am now completing the circle and coming back to the concept of photon in my last lecture. See, these are the expression of energy and momentum that I have written. Let us suppose m naught is equal to 0, okay. If m naught is equal to 0, normally energy will be 0 and momentum will be 0 because numerator has 0, okay. So, if rest mass of the particle is 0, then it may not have energy, it may not have momentum. But looking at these equations, you also get into one very, very interesting possibility. Remember, I can write E is equal to 0 only, of course, numerator is 0 if rest mass is 0, but denominator should not be 0. Then only 0 divided by something which is non-zero is 0. If I am dividing two zeros, 0 by 0, it may lead you to a constant value, okay. Because on the other hand, I can write this as m naught c square is equal to E multiplied by 1 minus u square by c square. If this is 0, then even with a non-zero value of E, this equation gets satisfied. Similarly, even with a non-zero value of momentum, if denominator also happens to be equal to c, then this equation will be satisfied. So, you want this to be 0, this m naught u, you can be written as p into under root 1 minus u square by c square. If denominator turns out to be 0, this equation will be satisfied. So, if it so happens that this denominator is also 0, then in that case it is possible that the particle could have E and particle could have P. It introduces a very, very interesting way of looking into the issue, that you may have a, there may be a possibility if response is 0, the particle may still possess energy and may still possess momentum, but in that case denominator must be 0, which means U must be equal to C. It means that particular particle must travel with speed of light. Okay, this is what I have been telling earlier, and this is what, as you know, photon is an example of a particular particle which comes from relativity. Of course, in this particular case, because kinetic energy has written as E has written as k plus m naught c square, because m naught c square turns out to be 0, you will always get E is equal to k. And there is another expression which I have used, E square is equal to p square c square plus m naught square c to the power 4. Okay, if m naught is 0, in that case relationship between energy and momentum will be just E is equal to p c. So, momentum will just turn out to be equal to E by c. This is what I have told earlier, that the momentum of a photon can be written as its energy divided by c. So, I give you an example, a particle with 0 rest mass with energy h nu and momentum h nu by c, okay, and light consists of photons. Now, I will work out two problems basically. One problem is a typical problem, and there is another problem which I am talking, which I talk about Compton effect, which I had promised you that when I am doing relativity, I will be talking about the Compton effect. So, this is one example. Okay, let me, before I go to this particular thing, let me introduce one thing about which, you know, a lot of students ask question and there is always a confusion. See, thing is that when I am taking a massive body and when I am trying to say that the two bodies, two particles collide, the mass of that particular particle will go up, okay, because it is completely an elastic collision. Now, lot of people ask this particular question, what will happen, for example, if two electrons collide in such a fashion, okay, will the mass of the electron will go up, okay. Of course, when I am talking the rest mass of the electron, my rest mass of the electron will always have a unique value. Okay, you cannot envisage a situation in which two particles, two electrons, for example, if at all could combine together, okay, of course there will be repulsive force, but forget about the repulsive force, could combine together, or for that matter, whatever it is, okay, they combine together and its rest mass becomes different. Okay, in that case, if you find there is, if there is a conservation of energy and conservation of momentum, okay, and both cannot be obeyed, this particular process will not be possible at all. In fact, this is one of the examples which we always give to the students, just to show that if there is an electron which is at rest, it cannot absorb a photon. Because if it absorbs a photon, both energy and momentum cannot be conserved. Okay, because rest mass of the electron will always remain rest mass of the electron, because electron is not expected to have an internal structure. But if I am talking with a big particle, okay, and the two big particles collide, then in principle it is possible that its rest mass goes up, because these have internal structure. It has, its rest mass has gone up because there is some sort of internal energy in the system which is existing. For example, this could be hot, this could have become hot. Okay, when this has become hot, actually what a particle being hot means, okay, that, you know, there is more lattice vibrations which are happening in this particular thing. So, I can envisage a situation when this particular particle can be heated and therefore its rest mass can go up. But on the other hand, electron, I do not expect this to be so, because it is not supposed to have an internal structure. Okay. Now, if you put the electron, give them energy, only thing that it can do is to translate. So, only energy that it will be able to have is additional kinetic energy. So, its rest mass could not change, would not change. This is a question which a lot of students ask. So, I thought, you know, I will sort of emphasize on this particular thing, that whenever I am saying that after result of collision, the mass has gone up, okay, these are assuming that these particular particles are massive which have some sort of internal structures. So, now let us take one particular example, which is a particle decay. Okay, now, as I say, particle mass and massive particle and non-massive particle, you know, all are replaced in relativity by just in the form of energies. So, let us suppose that there is a speed, there is a particular particle which has a rest mass of 1.35 MeV upon c square. See, in fact, as I say, then, you know, people are necessarily express, many times express the rest mass in the unit of energy. That is what I have been done. But to make it more scientifically correct or physically correct, I have said divided by c square. Because it is the mc square which has been given as 135 MeV. Loosely speaking, again, I mean, we are generally used to loose talking in physics also, so long we understand it. So, if I could have said that what the rest mass is 135 MeV, okay, but it is sort of understood that what I meant was mc square is equal to 135 MeV. So, let me be very clear here that rest mass of the particle is 135 MeV by c square. It is measured to be 0.8 C in a frame S. Okay. the particle is found to decay into two photons. So this particle disappears and decays into two photons. Each of these photons makes an angle theta with the initial direction of the particle. Find the angle and the frequency of the photon. Standard applying conservation of energy, conservation of momentum. So let's suppose we have a frame S, and let's suppose we have a particle here, which was originally traveling with a speed of 0.8 c. This particular particle decays, so the particle goes away, and now you have two particles which are coming up. One with energy, let's say EP1, let's say another EP2. You have to find out what is the angle of this particular thing, and you have to find out what will be the frequency of these photons. Okay, simple application of conservation of energy and momentum. So what you have to do, you have to find out what is the initial energy of this particle. You have to find out what is the energy of initial momentum of the particle. Then, using these theta values and EP1 and EP2, you have to find out what will be the final energies and final momentum. Of course, when you are talking of momentum conservation, momentum being vector, so x direction and y direction momentum or momenta will be conserved separately. So you have to conserve x component of momentum, you have to conserve y component of momentum, and then solve the equations to find out what will be the value of theta and what will be the value of energies of the photons. Once we know the energy of the photon, I can always find out what will be the frequency of the photon. So let's work it out. So let's talk about the initial particle. We talk about gamma u. Again, I said 0.8 gives you a clean number, there is no under root. So this turns out to be 5/3. So let us write the energy of the incident particle, which will be written by gamma u m naught c square. M naught c square I have given you is 135 MeV. Gamma u turns out to be 5/3. It means the total initial energy of the particle is 5/3 multiplied by 135 is 225 MeV. So the energy of the particle, which was just before decay, was 225 MeV. Now what would have been its momentum? Its momentum would have been again gamma u m naught u. Gamma u is 5/3. M naught is 135 by c square multiplied by u, which is 0.8 c. You express this particular thing, the momentum will be 180 MeV by c. But often we represent in these particular problems the momentum in the unit of MeV by c. So this particular p will be equal to c. Remember, the c will cancel out one of the squares, so you will have c. So this I have written c here. If you take all these numbers, this number will give you 180. So this will be 180 MeV by c. This will be the momentum of this particular particle. Now it decays into photons. So I have to conserve energy and momentum. I have to look at the energy and momentum of the final particles, okay, and then conserve them. If EP1 and EP2 are the energies of the two photons, then of course I must get, because they are not vectors, so some of their energy has to be 225 MeV. This is my energy conservation. Because initially the energy of the particle was 225 MeV. So as a result of this decay, you will find that the final energy has to be 225 MeV. Now I conserve the momentum along the x direction. Okay, so you, initial momentum was only along the x direction, but when you are talking the momentum of these two particles, okay, this will also have a y component. Of course, y component will cancel it out, and the x component you have to find it out here. So this will be EP1 cos theta plus EP2 cos theta. Rather not EP1, but P1 cos theta and P1 cos theta again. Okay, and because these are photons, so I know relationship between energy and momentum are fairly simple. Momentum of this particular photon will be just E by C. So I have written E by C cos theta. Then similarly for the second particle, E by C cos theta. And originally the momentum was only along the x direction. So some of these two momentum must be the momentum in the x direction of the original particle, which was 180 MeV upon C. So these two must be 180 MeV upon C. Now in y direction there was no initial momentum, so in final direction also there cannot be any momentum. Therefore, the y component of the momentum must be equal and opposite. So I have just cancelled this particular thing. EP1 upon C, which was the momentum value, sin theta, which is the y component, EP2 by C, sin theta, they must be equal. Now because we have been told that these thetas are same, so these thetas will cancel out, C will cancel out, which gives you EP1 is equal to EP2. It means you know the particles share equal energy. So energy of each particle will be 225 divided by 2. Now you put that particular value here. These two terms become equal. Just find out what is the cos theta value. So this is what I have done. Quickly, I will just tell you. This gives you EP1 is equal to EP2 is equal to 112.5, which is just 225 divided by 2. And cos theta prime, because you know you will have 2 times this particular term. So when you are taking this, you know you will get 2 times 112.5, which will give you 225. And this C will eventually cancel it out. So you will just get cos theta is equal to 180 divided by 225. Okay, just calculate theta from this, turns out to be 37 degree approximate. So this particular photon will travel at an angle of 37 degrees because it has to conserve both energy and momentum. Now let's come back to our wave particle duality from which we had started our series of lectures. At that time we had mentioned about this thing probably, but you know, did not discussed. We had said that photoelectric effect actually provides a very standard proof of the presence of photons, and that fact that photon possesses energy which is equal to h nu, which combines the both wave and particle aspect. Okay, I don't remember, probably had mentioned that particular time that photoelectric effect does not give you any idea about the momentum of the photon. It only tells about the energy of the photon, because as I have told you that if you have really a particular particle, let's assume that there is a particle at rest. It does not matter whether if it is moving with a constant velocity also, because you can always go to a frame of reference in which this particular particle is at rest. Okay, it can be shown that this particular particle cannot absorb a photon. So a photon which comes here, it's not possible that this particular particle will absorb photon, because in that particular case both energy and momentum cannot be conserved. Okay, so this particular process will not take place, because I expect conservation and of momentum and energy to be always valid. If it's not possible to satisfy, that particular process is banned. It's not possible to have that particular process. So a free particle cannot absorb a photon. All right, so either you have to make photon, this particular particle bound, then it's possible to absorb the photon, or only part of the energy of this particular photon should be given to this particular particle and the particle should require. So first experiment is what we call as a photoelectric effect experiment, which is always performed when this particular particle, this particular electron is sort of bound inside the system. When it's bound in this particular system, it requires certain amount of energy to release the electron, then it's possible to conserve energy and momentum. But because this particular photon gets now bound to a much bigger atom or a solid, okay, essentially the momentum conservation is absorbed, momentum is absorbed by that particular particle, and it's very, very difficult to test the conservation of momentum. It's almost like that if I throw a ball on a wall in your room, okay, and I want to test conservation of momentum, I will not be successful, because to me it appears as if momentum has not conserved, because the ball has gone and get reflected back. So what was the initial momentum of the wall, okay, has just reversed back its direction. The fact is that momentum is still conserved in that particular process. Whatever was the difference of the momentum was taken by this wall, which has been rigidly connected to Earth. So strictly speaking, the Earth velocity would have slightly changed because of this collision. All right, but on the other hand, Earth is so big that by making such small change in its velocity, you will never be able to measure it. Okay, so you will, by performing this experiment, you will never be able to check whether momentum conservation is valid or not. So that's what is happening in the case of photoelectric effect experiment, that it's not possible to check whether, of course, you can check that energy is equal to h nu, but you will not be able to check that its momentum is h nu by c. For that, I require a second process in which only part of the energy of the photon is taken by the electron, and that is what is called Compton effect. This is what is Compton effect. As I mentioned, now I take electron to be a free electron, and let's assume that the photon is incident on it. But unlike photoelectric effect, where I assume that this photon is absorbed, here you still have a photon, but now with a reduced energy, it means with a larger wavelength or a lower frequency. So this is a process in which electron interacts with the photon, and an outcome, there is a photon, and of course, because part of the energy is given to electron, so electron is no longer stationary, okay, and it also recoils, it also starts moving. So this electron goes this way, this photon goes this way, and let us suppose these angles are theta and phi. I will apply conservation of energy and momentum exactly in the way I applied in a problem which I have done just now. So it's a recoil of photon by a free electron going ahead with the idea that light shows a particle nature, of course, with the photon concept. And here I should be able to find out what will be the changes of frequency by application of conservation of energy and momentum, and satisfy ourselves, and that matches with the experiment. So I write conservation equations. So we can go a little faster now, because you know we have solved exactly one problem like this. See, initial value of the momentum in the x direction was h nu by c. Remember, unlike the earlier problem, here it was the photon which is coming from the x direction, so originally, and the electron was at rest, so its momentum was 0, the momentum of photon was h nu upon c. Finally, you have one photon and one electron. For photon, I can write the momentum is h nu upon prime by c, where nu prime is the new frequency of the photon. But about electron, I have more complicated relationship because its rest mass is not 0. Okay, so I have to put p e cos phi. Then, just like I have written earlier, in y along the y direction, the momentum was 0 initially. So, finally, also it has to be 0. So, the y component of the momentum of the photon will be h nu prime upon c sin theta, like the problem I did just now. But for the electron, now I have to use still p because the relationship between momentum and energy will be given by this expression. So, this is the momentum conservation in y direction. Now, conservation of energy, even though the electron was at rest, it had energy, which is the rest mass energy. So, this was the energy of the electron, this was the energy of the photon. So, overall, this was the total energy and that should be conserved. Now, it means that the total energy of the electron, okay, this includes rest mass energy, total relativistic energy of the electron plus h nu prime must match this. And of course, we have a relationship between E and P, which is required. So, I have to solve this equation, which is E square is equal to P square C square plus M naught C square C to the power of 4, because M naught for electron is not 0. Therefore, I have to use this particular equation to solve it. Okay. Now, I will sort of speed through, go through faster the, through the mathematics. Probably you can work it out yourself. I will anyway be uploading these things on Moodle. Okay. So, first thing that we do, we eliminate phi. In fact, what we do in actual experiments, very, very difficult to find out the recoil of the electron, and therefore, to measure property energy of the electron and momentum of the electron or the angle to which electron has recoiled is little tough. So, I want to get rid of this thing. So, what I will do, I will first eliminate phi. So, for eliminating phi, I will use sin phi term and a cosine phi term. So, I will take sin square phi plus cos square phi, which will give you 1. So, I will eliminate first the phi term using these two equations. This is what I have done here. Okay. So, I have used this particular cosine phi from the first equation, sin phi from the second equation. Okay. And this particular cos square phi plus sin square phi is written in this particular fashion. So, phi gets eliminated in this equation. Then what we want to do, I want to eliminate the momentum of electron also, because momentum of electron, as I say, is difficult to measure. That I can do using the fourth equation, which is p square c square is equal to e square minus m naught square c to the power 4. I have just changed the terms. Now, as far as this particular energy is concerned, this is p square c square. I know this energy can be written from this particular expression, which is m naught c square plus h nu minus h nu. So, use that particular expression to write this particular energy. Okay. You work out this particular thing. Now, you can also find out a relationship from this particular thing about momentum. See, remember this equation, I have to write p square c square. So, p square I will use from this expression. So, I will multiply by get c square here. So, this will become h nu minus h nu prime upon cos theta whole square, because this will cancel once I multiply by c square. Similarly, this c will cancel because they are square, remember here. So, for p square c square, I can use this expression which I have used here. Okay. This particular expression. Then I have used this particular expression for of the square using that particular equation from this equation. H nu minus e is equal to m naught c square plus h nu minus h nu prime. So, once you use this particular expression here, okay, you will be able to solve these equations, and this equation turns out to be somewhat simpler. If instead of nu I use lambda, so I take this c by lambda, and eventually I obtain this standard equation of Compton effect, that lambda prime minus lambda is equal to h upon m naught c 1 minus cos theta. Remember, theta is the angle to which a photon is scattered. Okay, this is the changed wavelength. Okay, this is what is called a Compton wavelength of electron. Alright. So, now let us try to interpret and try to see if we have to perform an experiment, how we can perform this particular experiment. First, let us discuss this particular result. We find that the wavelength increases, which means energy decreases, which is very, very standard. Okay. But this increase is independent of the wavelength. Remember, increase is depends, there is no lambda here appearing here. Okay. So, irrespective of what lambda you use, okay, you will always get the same thing. It depends on h upon m naught c, which are all fundamental constants, okay, and only the angle, and depends only on the scattering angle. Lambda c is equal to h upon m naught c is called Compton wavelength. Of course, in this I have to use mass of electron, because I am assuming this particular particle is mass or is electron. Of course, this expression would have been true instead of mass if I would have used some other expression. The value of this particular lambda c, if you just substitute these things, turns out to be 2.43 newton power minus 3 nanometers, which is exceedingly small. Now you also notice that delta lambda is equal to 0 for theta is equal to 0. If your theta is equal to 0, then 1 minus 1 will give you 0. So lambda prime minus lambda is 0 and will be equal to 2 lambda c for theta is equal to 180 degrees. If I put 180 degrees, I get minus 1. So you will get 2 lambda prime, 2 times Compton wavelength for theta is equal to 180 degrees. Therefore, because this lambda c being very, very small and maximum change that you are going to get is only twice the Compton wavelength, okay, if you have to take, you know, difference of like 0.2 or 0.5 angstrom in the wavelength of, let's say, optical light, which has itself a wavelength of 5000 angstrom approximately, okay, it's very, very difficult to measure this thing. So these experiments are generally performed using gamma rays, okay, where wavelength themselves are very, very small. So the change that you are seeing is a reasonable percentage of the original wavelength, and it's easier to determine it. Okay, of course, as I said, this equation is valid even if you use particle other than electron to scatter the photon. Of course, in that case, we have to use m naught as the mass of that particular particle which is scattering the photon. Now, this is the experimental setup. Theoretically, it's very easy to say that, assume that there is an electron at rest. But how do I put an electron at rest in a laboratory? It's not possible. Okay, and electrons, as you know, that are, they react very, very strongly with the matter. And if at all you have to use, I mean even the standard photoreactive experiment, you have to have vacuum so that you can see those electrons. Okay, or the experiment is performed in a vacuum tube. All right, so it's not possible. The nearest that we can get is a free electron is in a metal. Okay, Professor Suresh must have talked about the metals. Okay, in metals there are large number of electrons which can be approximately considered free. They are not really free. In fact, free electron theory doesn't work, but they are the closest to the reality. Okay, so of course they are moving with large speeds, but you know, as I say, I do not mind if the electron moves with a particular speed, because I can always go to a frame of reference in which this particular electron is at rest. Okay, so let's assume that in this particular metal we have some electron which are having no force on them, so they move with a constant velocity. Okay, though we know that this particular thing is not really correct, so we always use a metallic target and allow incident gamma ray to be incident here. Then you put your detector at an angle theta from the original direction of gamma rays. Now only those photons which are scattered in this direction will be detected. Then you can actually count these particular number of photons for a given number of time, given amount of time, and plot this as a function of theta by making these measurements as function of theta. So this is precisely what we do in a experiment involving Compton effect. When you perform this experiment, you get something like this. So very, very interesting. You get basically, I mean, this is not really experimental. I have tried to roughly draw it. If you want to see some standard curves, you know, you should probably look into some textbooks. Okay, so the total number of photons which are being detected by a detector in a given time, okay, as a function of lambda prime, okay, turned out to be this particular thing, or as function, okay, this is the value of lambda prime which are being measured as function of, you are finding out n as function of this. Now there are two, three important results that you try to get it here, that you find out. Okay, let me also just tell you that what you do as a function of, okay, let me first explain this thing. Now you have, first of all, you find a width which is larger here and a width which is smaller here. Okay, now we have already done the uncertainty principle, so I don't have to explain that there is always going to be a natural line width. You know, photons will never have exactly the same wavelengths. Okay, there is also always going to be a finite line width, but here you find that there is additional broadening of the line width, and this particular additional broadening occurs because of the fact that you are actually able to get, there are a lot of electrons which are also traveling with different speeds. The speed of all the electrons in a metal is not constant because they are traveling with different speeds. Okay, you can show that because of the distribution of the speeds of the electrons, you will find that these widths get broadened. But what is more important, that if you perform, okay, let me just mention, see, when you are performing the experiment as a particular theta, you also keep on measuring their energy distribution. So when you are doing theta, you are not only counting the total number of photons which are coming, you are also counting their energies. So you can really check that whether their energies or their wavelengths correspond to the expression of the Compton wavelength that I have used. Now what you do, you essentially find at that particular value of theta a large number of photons which are coming with a distribution of energies which are something like this. So that is what is the lambda prime for a fixed value of theta. if you perform this experiment at different values of theta, what you will find that one of the values which is corresponding to, let us say, the separation of these particular lines will keep on going up, and this particular peak will not change its position, only the separation will keep on going up. Now, the second question is that why you are getting two different values of lambda. Now, if you take the larger value of lambda prime and calculate it from the original value of lambda, you do find that lambda prime minus lambda satisfy that condition of Compton expression that I have obtained. But what is interesting that why you are getting also the original wavelength, this peak corresponds to approximately the original wavelength, and this is present because of the fact that inside a metal you do not have only electrons, you also have nuclei which are heavy nuclei or heavy basically nuclei or protons or whatever you want to call heavier particles. So, once the photon comes, okay, it need not get scattered only from electrons, it can also get scattered from heavier particles like nuclei, and they will also get Compton scattered, but in that case the shift will be given by h upon m naught c, where m naught is the mass of that particular heavy particle, and m naught being very large, the shift, Compton shift, is going to be exceedingly small. Therefore, you see a peak which corresponds to more or less the original wavelength, and there is another peak which results because of actually the Compton scattering of photons from the electrons. So, you do find that this particular relationship is valid, and you prove using this Compton effect experiment that this particular relationship about the momentum of the photon, okay, which we have obtained from energy conservation and momentum conservation, is experimentally verified. So, now I will stop, and as I said, this will be my last lecture. So, all the best to you. If there are few questions, we can probably take. Yes, Namakkal, Nanmani College of Engineering.
Whether the velocity change of two respective objects involved in a collision will equal or not?
See, it depends on again the type of initial conditions that you are putting and what are the masses of the particle. Okay, it is like a standard collision problem. See, like if I am talking of a classical particle, if I am talking of two particular particles which are sort of colliding, it depends on, for example, what is their scattering angle, okay, and eventually conservation of energy and momentum. So, velocity changes etcetera would depend on what type of particles are there and how they are interacting. Okay. So, it cannot, one cannot answer this question, you know, just in a simple blanket way. Okay. It depends on what are the conditions, how these particular particles have interacted, whether this is purely a one-dimensional collision or there is a two-dimensional collision, and after the collision one particle goes this way, another particle goes this way. It depends on so many other factors. But only thing that I am emphasizing, that irrespective of the type of the collision, energy and momentum both have to be conserved. Ranga Swami College.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, the term mass in special theory of relativity is referred as rest mass.
Yeah.
Then how it is possible the massless particles exist here?
How is it possible what?
Here, sir.
No, I did not hear the last part of your question.
Massless particles.
Okay. See, I mean, as I say, I given you my logic about that particular thing, that this, I mean, see, only thing when you are saying that there is a massless particle which has a zero rest mass, okay, this particular particle cannot be put to rest, okay, because this will always move with the speed of light, okay, and you know in any frame of reference that you go, speed of light will always remain speed of light, okay. So, that particular particle you will never be able to put at rest, so, I mean, its rest mass is zero and therefore, you cannot put it at rest. I think that is the best answer I can give.
Then the theory of relativity is possible to apply for fundamental particles if the mass are not considered here, mass of the particles are not considered.
See, I'm not sure what, I'm not able to understand your fully the question, but thing is that of course special theory of relativity is always applied to any physics provided you are talking of that particular energy range. And especially in fundamental particles that becomes a little more important, because when you are talking of the particle interaction, you are talking of decays etcetera and all those things, okay, this particular it is important to talk about the special theory of relativity. That is the only way one can understand them.
There, one more question.
Yeah, please.
Basic difference between special theory of relativity and general theory of relativity.
That is what I told last time also. In special theory of relativity, we are only dealing with the frames of references in which are inertial. General theory of relativity is more complex. In fact, I tried to answer this question last time also, okay, which includes non-inertial frame of reference and try to compare with the gravity. Take that particular thing, especially that is based on the fact that your inertial mass and the gravitational mass value turn out to be same. Okay. So, it is little more general, which also includes gravity, okay, while in this particular case of special theory of relativity, we are only dealing with inertial inertial frames.
Okay.
Yes, RBS Engineering College. Okay. Yeah, please.
Sir, can we see ourselves slower due to relativity, time relativity?
Can we see ourselves
slower due to time relativity?
No, no. See, the thing, relativity is required only when you are changing from one frame to another frame of reference. Of course, see, let's be very clear. See, if I am only my own frame of reference, then at that particular time in my frame of reference, of course, I have to apply a new definition of momentum, new definition of energy, okay? But, okay, if I am trying to say that my velocity changes, you know, only somebody else has to observe. So, when I am talking of transformation, it's transformation between two different frames. Okay, so if a particular particle is moving with this particular velocity and is being observed by one observer, another observer would always observe this particular particle and may find its velocity to be different. Now, in my own frame, I am always at rest. So, there is no way that I can talk of my own velocity. I am always at rest in my own frame of reference. So, you have to talk only of different frames. And when you are talking of relativity, especially these transformation equations, talk of what happens in one frame of reference and how do you connect this to what happens in another frame of reference, or rather what is observed in another frame of reference.
Okay, thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Sir, when light travels in a medium, is there any equation to show the conservation of energy and momentum?
See, the thing is that, you know, see, as I say, energy and momentum are supposed to be general relationship, which is always supposed to be valid. Okay. Now, as far as the speed of light is traveling in a medium, in fact, I told about this particular thing last time also, that when I am talking of speed of light being constant in different frame, I always mean speed of light in vacuum. Though I have not been categorically mentioning every time, but it's always the speed of light in vacuum. When you go into a medium, the speed of light will become different, but that's what relativity does not talk about. It's always about the medium, because only in the vacuum that this particular expression C is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught is correct.
Sir, one more question, please.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, can I have your valuable comments on two paradox? Is it the reality in terms of biological age and all that?
See, the thing is that I have not talked about twin paradox. I have not talked about length contraction. I would not like to talk about it because that takes enormous amount of time. What I will say, because they are paradox, there are methods of solving those paradoxes. You can look at any of the standard books, you know, in which about they are talked in details about the paradoxes. Normally, at the first year level, I don't like to talk about paradoxes. I mean, they are very, very interesting concepts. But the thing is that, you know, that takes you away from the main physics aspect of relativity, and in a limited time, we don't want to talk about those things. Okay, but I would suggest that you can look at some of the books, you know, in which these paradoxes, I mean, there are three or four paradoxes which we talk in relativity, and all of them have been discussed in great detail how to solve these particular things, how these paradoxes can be removed, can be sort of dissipated with by using proper logics.
Okay, thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. Bye-bye and have a good lunch.
Bye.